To all the students, I am your biology teacher, Mrs. Hima Rajesh. Today I will be covering biological classification. Briefly, I will run through how to access revision notes and test in clay6.com. Open the clay6.com webpage, then go to practice. Click on the practice. You will see a lot of packages here. Today I am going to select NEET Premium. Sorry, there was an interruption with my network. Now I'm back. Okay, now you can see a lot of tests in physics, chemistry, biology, both of 11th and 12th, and NEET full tests over here. Now if you click on biology, now you will see chapter wise tests given here. Now some of the chapters, depending upon the importance and the difficulty level, where students always find difficult to answer the questions in NEET, we have created, and the number of tests are also increased, giving weightage to its importance in the NEET exams and also the difficulty level. Now you are seeing different kinds of colored bubbles here, children. So if you see a yellow colored bubble, that means to say that test has not been attempted. If you see a green color bubble, it means to say I completed the test. Though I have completed the test, I can again take the test again and again. Since suppose I have got less marks in test 2, then after 2 or 3 days, maybe after looking at the answers and learning, I might want to check and see whether I am able to recall. Then I can go back and take the test again. And blue test is also to be, we have to take the test. Bubble shows that I have incompleted the test. I have not completed the test. And a blue bubble shows that I have yet to take the test. And this is a random test. Suppose you want to see the different levels of difficulty and random wise concept wise, then you can click this test. I'm going to get back to this later. Now you might be wondering, because you're all going to give your NEET, what kind of questions really come in NEET since it's been transferred from CBSE board to NTA. You can be assured there is no much change between NTA and NTA as a paper setter. They are online and on par with CBSE. So if you look at biology, most of the seniors would have said, or people who have been very successful would have said, for biology, NCERT is the Bible. So many students ask me, ma'am, should I really learn and memorize the entire textbook? How is it possible? It is not possible. But you need to read religiously. So if you look at NCERT based questions, approximately 68 to 70 questions in the examination are directly from NCERT books. They can be attempted easily by those who read NCERT religiously. So you have to repeatedly keep reading our textbook, children, as though it is a holy Bible. Direct from previous year's question papers, if you look at it, either straight 8 to 10 questions are asked from previous papers, either directly as they were in the past question papers, or with a few modifications. And these questions are repeated sometimes with or without any modifications. So again, I'm saying, if you relook at our package, as I said, there are a lot of tests I will tell you at the end. If you really practice it, it's going to help you immensely. And modified questions are there. These at least 8 to 10 questions in the NEET will be newer questions. They would not have appeared anywhere else. And these questions become the game changer, for they can't be solved by mere mugging of facts. Though they are from NCERT book, to get them right, you need to apply the knowledge that you have about the subject. So in this website, we have made an earnest attempt in creating the test that would help you to tackle all the three kinds of questions so that you get very high marks. Now I hope you got the framework of how NEET biology would be there. Now here you see, if you revision notes, if you click this, it will be taking you to revision notes. These revision notes are prepared in keeping in mind what is most important from NCERT point of view, so that you will be able to select, able to get good marks. And if you click this bubble, it will open in a PDF. Now, since I had to scroll down to get to biology, I've already scrolled down and kept it to the lesson. Now, I'm going to get into the lesson. So, this is second lesson, biological classification. Since the time immemorial, since the time of civilization, classification has been a part and parcel of human beings. It was done instinctively without having any scientific criteria, depending upon their needs and convenience. So whatever they felt in the earlier times, they started doing it. But scientifically, it started, even I would say classification started right from the time of Aristotle. He divided plants into herbs, shrubs and trees, and animals were all divided into those with RBCs and without RBCs. Later on, two kingdom system of classification was proposed by Carl von Linnaeus. He classified organisms into plant kingdom and animal kingdom. But the main drawback of for Linnaeus was there was no distinction between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. He did not take into consideration whether the organisms were prokaryotes or eukaryotes. He did not separate multicellular organisms from unicellular organisms. And also he did not make any distinction between photosynthetic and non-photosynthetic organisms. Now, later on, because of these difficulties, what they faced, as we said, the classification system has evolved over the time. Five kingdom system of classification was proposed by Whittaker, and this is what is now commonly followed. So he classified the organisms into five kingdoms, namely Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. Today, in today's class and in this lesson, we will be learning about the three kingdoms, Monera, Protista, Fungi. Plantae and Animalia will be dealt as separate lessons in future. Now, let us get back to Kingdom Monera. So, Kingdom Monera includes all prokaryotes. So, you know what are prokaryotes. So, let us, how is it divided? So, it is divided broadly into archaebacteria and eubacteria. I have also included mycoplasma because mycoplasma does not belong either to archaebacteria or eubacteria, but still it is placed under Kingdom Monera. Now, if you look at archaebacteria, these are the bacterial organisms which live in extreme conditions. And they include organisms that live like in salty places like halophiles, in hot springs, and they are called thermacidophiles, and methanogens that live in the marshy areas. And they also live in the guts of the ruminants. Now, the cell wall structure is different from bacteria. And because of this cell wall structure is different, they are able to live in the harsh conditions. Now, let us look into eubacteria. Now, these are the true bacteria. And these can be divided into different criteria. Now, based upon the criteria that is very much essential, I'm going to talk to you about the criteria. Please make a note because a few questions have been asked. So based on the shape, if you look at the bacterial shape, based on their shape, they are classified into cocci, that is a spherical in structure, bacilli, they are rod shaped, and then spirillum, spiral shaped, and vibrio, which are comma shaped. Now bacterial classification based on flagella, if you see, they are classified as monotrichus, trichus is flagellum here. Monotrichus means one flagella at one end. Lophotrichus means a tuft of flagella at one end of the cell. Amphitrichus means tuft of bacteria arising at both ends of the cell. Peritrichus means flagella all over the body. Atrichus, bacteria without flagella. So this, they might ask you, showing the diagram, they might ask you to identify whether it is monotrichus, lophotrichus, amphitrichus, peritrichus or atrichus. That is why I gave you this. Now, what are the other classificatory systems based on how are they classified further? They are classified based on their ability to utilize oxygen or not. And they need oxygen, they are aerobic bacteria. And they don't need oxygen, they are considered as anaerobic bacteria. Now, if you look at the other classification, gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, Sir Hans Grant came out with a staining technique. The bacteria that retained a purple color after staining were called as gram-positive bacteria. And bacteria that lacked the purple coloration after staining were called as gram-negative bacteria. Now, you know that let us now look into the based on their nutrition. They are classified into photosynthetic autotrophs. It includes cyanobacteria and anabaena and chemosynthetic bacteria. These are the autotrophs which oxidize various inorganic substrates like nitrates, nitrites, ammonia and release energy. For the use the released energy for ATP production, and heterotrophic bacteria are mostly decomposers. Now let us look into mycoplasma. These are extremely small organisms. Their size is about 0.3 microns. They are completely lack a cell wall. These are the smallest living cells, can survive aerobically, and they are pathogenic in most of the plants and animals. So whatever you have studied for 3 pages, we have tried to put concisely, we have tried to see that it is put in a concise form in the form of an organizer. So this is about Kingdom Monera. Now let us look into Kingdom Protista. So if you look at Protista, what is the difference between Kingdom Monera and Protista? Means Protista comprises of all single-celled eukaryotes, and that is they have a well-defined nucleus and cell organelles. They are primarily aquatic organisms. They form a link between plants, animals and fungi. And they reproduce both sexually and asexually. Now we have summarized the different classes in this PDF. Let me show you this. So if you look at this, you'll find the 5 classes here: rhizophytes, dinoflagellates, euglenoids, slime molds, and protozoans. If you look at rhizophytes are popularly known as diatoms and desmids. And mind you, diatoms are the chief producers in the ocean. This is very important and you need to remember. They are microscopic, thriving in both fresh and marine water. Most of them are photosynthetic. The cell walls form overlapping sheet-like structure like a soap box. Cell wall is made up of silica, and after the organisms die, the silica gets accumulated to form diatomaceous earth, or it is also called kieselguhr. Since it is very gritty, it is used in polishing, filtration of oils and syrups. Now let us get back to the next class, that is dinoflagellates. Now these dinoflagellates are mostly marine and photosynthetic. They will appear in different colors like yellow, green, brown, blue or red depending on the pigments, which can be chlorophylls, xanthophylls, fucoxanthins, carotenoids, etc. Most of them have 2 flagella that are placed longitudinally and transversely in a furrow between the wall plates. You might have heard of red tides. That is, heard red tides happening. So in the oceans, when this goniolops reproduces or multiplies explosively, it's a red algae. It imparts red color to the water. And this is known as the red tide. And the toxins that they produce will kill many marine organisms. Now, euglenoids, these have pellicle, which is a protein rich, and instead of a cell wall. As a result of which, these euglenoids will have a flexible body. Now they are photosynthetic in presence of sunlight, so they become autotrophs. In the absence of sunlight, they become heterotrophs. Example, it is not paramecium children, it is euglena. It's a printing mistake. Now slime molds, they are saprophytic protists. They form aggregates to form, they say in your textbook they have given it as plasmodium, but actually it is pseudoplasmodium. So you should have it as pseudoplasmodium, that is a false plasmodium. They grow on dead and decaying leaves. Spores have true walls that are extremely resistant and can survive for many years. That is the reason why when there are harsh conditions, these spores will remain inert. They do not get disturbed at all and they remain as it is. Once on the return of favorable conditions, they will start germinating and then they will start growing. Now, the last class is the protozoans. So the protozoans are heterotrophs. They live as predators or parasites. Now, if you look at the four groups of protozoans, they are classified based on their locomotory organs. Now, if you look at amoeba, in amoeba, you know, it is amoeboid protozoan. Pseudopodia is the main locomotory organ and it also helps in catching the prey. Now, flagellated protozoans, they have flagella for locomotion. Example, Trypanosoma gambiense. This is important because it causes African sleeping sickness. Now, ciliated protozoan, they have cilia for locomotion and also to push the food into the gullet. Example, Paramecium. Sporozoans have infective spore stage in the life cycle. Example, Plasmodium. This Plasmodium is very important because this Plasmodium causes malaria. Now, there are four important species, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium ovale and Plasmodium malariae. Out of this, Plasmodium falciparum causes malignant tertian malaria, which is very, very fatal. Now, we have seen Kingdom Monera, Kingdom Protista. Now, let us try to look into Kingdom Fungi. Now, before that, let me show you one slide. That is on nostoc. So if you look at the nostoc here, this diagram, they might ask you with the choice A, B and C to identify the name of the organism nostoc. This cell they can show you and ask you to identify it is heterocyst and the sheath is a mucilaginous sheath and also they will give the kingdom. So you have to identify correctly the choice. This is very, very important. Okay, now let us look at Kingdom Fungi. Now you must have heard about fungal diseases. You might have experienced fungal diseases like skin irritation or scalp irritation or in the nail. Or you might have just seen the bread molds growing on the bread. So these are all due to the formation of fungi. Suppose you have left some eatable which is wet outside. After a few days, after 2 or 3 days, you see beautiful coloring, colored thread-like structures would have appeared in different colors. So these all belong to the kingdom fungi. So these are heterotrophic organisms, can live both as parasites or saprophytes. Body has long, slender, thread-like structure called hyphae. Mass of hyphae form the mycelium. They can also get into symbiotic relationship as in lichens with algae or mycorrhiza as in roots of higher plants. Asexually, they reproduce by the formation of conidia, sporangiospores or zoospores. So if you had to remember this spores, conidia, sporangiospore or zoospores, remember computer screen on Zoom or Zoom the computer screen. So if you remember this anagram, you will get the asexual spores. Sexually reproduced by the formation of basidiospores, oospores or ascospores. Remember BOA. That is B stands for basidiospores, O for oospores and A for ascospores. Now there are three steps during their sexual life cycle. They are plasmogamy, karyogamy, meiosis. So plasmogamy refers to fusion of the protoplast. So when two hyphal strains of fungi come together, then their protoplasm will fuse, that is called as plasmogamy. Later on, the nucleus will fuse, resulting in karyogamy. And finally, the meiosis is seen in the zygote, which results in the formation of haploid spores. So these three steps are very important. They will jumble the steps and ask you to identify. So remember PKM. Now, depending upon the morphology of the mycelium, mode of spore formation and fruiting bodies form the division of kingdom. That is how kingdom classes are formed in fungi means these are the criteria. That is morphology, mode of spore formation and fruiting bodies, which we have summarized it here. Now the five classes are phycomycetes, ascomycetes, basidiomycetes and deuteromycetes. Now let me look at phycomycetes. They are all are aquatic organisms. Mycelium is aseptate or cenocytic. Cenocytic means multinucleate cell, which is due to multiple karyokinesis. That means to say that nucleus has divided many times without cytokinesis, as a result of which you will find multinucleate cell condition. Now, zoospores are motile and aplanospores, which are non-motile, are produced for asexual reproduction. They show isogamy, anisogamy and oogamy. So you might be familiar with these terms. But anyhow, I shall be telling you, recapping you. Now, isogamy means gametes that are similar in morphology. When they unite together or fuse, you call it as isogamy. When gametes are dissimilar, you call it as anisogamy. Now, oogamy is another form of anisogamy, where the female gamete is significantly larger than the male gamete and it is non-motile. Now, examples phycomycetes are rhizopus and albugo. Now, ascomycetes, it is the sac fungi. It is also known as sac fungi. Here, the mycelium, it's multicellular, but yeast is an exception. It is unicellular in nature. It is saprophytic, decomposers, parasitic or coprophilus. Coprophilus means living on the cow dung. Mycelium is branched and septate. They asexually produce through conidiospores. Sexual spores are ascospores. Now, example are Aspergillus, Penicillium, Neurospora, Claviceps, etc. Neurospora is called as the Cinderella of genetics because it is extensively used in genetical experiments. And Claviceps is very important because it yields that drug called ergotamine, which is used in LSD, which is a narcotic drug. Now, basidiomycetes. Mushrooms are called basidia and they are club shaped. Mycelium, again here it is septate. Asexual spores are absent. Vegetative reproduction is through fragmentation. Sexual reproduction is through the formation of basidiospores. Example, Agaricus, Ustilago, etc. And Puccinia is also another example for basidiomycetes. Deuteromycetes. This is called the fungi imperfecti because here the mycelium is septate or branched, it's all fine. But you do not find a perfect sexual stage. The problem is when the asexual spores, they will be able to divide through reproduce through asexual spores. But when their sexual cycle is understood, they are either motor ascomycetes or basidiomycetes. So for those of the organisms, even till now, when the sexual stage has not been discovered, they have been separated and they have been kept as under fungi imperfecti. Now, example, Alternaria, Colitotrichum, Trichoderma, etc. And most of the plant diseases are caused by deuteromycetes or fungi imperfecti. Now, I'm going to project you a slide, which is important. Please make a note of this slide, children. Classes of fungi. So, this is very, very important. So you see phycomycetes, example, Saprolegnia, Rhizopus, Mucor, Albugo, Pythium, Ascomycetes, Yeast, Aspergillus, Penicillium, Neurospora, Pezaiza, Basidiomycetes, Agaricus, Polyporus, Puccinia, Ustilago, Lycoperdon, Deuteromycetes, Cercospora, Colitotrichum, Trichoderma, Pericularia, Fusarium. So these are all, this is an important slide. That's why I'm projecting. Please make a note. These examples, they will give you and ask you to identify, or they will give you a set of examples and ask you to identify the incorrect ones or to which class do these belong to, that they can ask you. Fungal diseases, So these diseases are important. Please make a note. Wilt of cotton in plants caused by Fusarium oxysporum species, Vaz infecticum. Ticca disease of caused by Cercospora personata. This they have Vaz many number of times. And red rot of sugarcane, Colitotrichum falcatum. In humans, you have ringworm of Epidermophyton species and ringworms of Trichophyton species. Candidiasis is caused by Candida albicans or Albugo candida. Both are the same. Now, here in this, we have not mentioned about animals and plants because, as I said, that they are dealt under separate chapter, so we did not include this in the PDF. But I will give you a brief view of plant classification. Kingdom Plantae is broadly divided into Cryptogamae, Phanerogamae. Cryptogamae into algae, bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperms. Phanerogamae is angiosperms, monocots, and dicots. Again, you don't have to take this down because I will be starting again from this in the next lesson. Now, let us look at viruses. Now, viruses, viroids, and lichens are not included under Whittaker's classification. So, they have given at the end of the lesson for you to have an idea. So, you know viruses. Now, amidst this COVID, we all are aware of the word virus and we know how fatal it could be. Actually, on whole of the earth, it is 1 gram of virus that is found. And it has brought down the globally everybody literally onto their knees. That is the power of these viruses. They are living entities because only in the presence of a host cell, they are capable of replicating. If they are not, they do not have a suitable host, they remain as non-living entity for some time. And that is the problem even with this COVID-19. Now, if you look at this, the viruses, they are living entities as they can be crystallized and stored as chemical crystals and reproduce in living host cells by taking over the host genetic machinery. And these terms, these scientists are very important. Virus was coined by Pasteur. The term virus was coined by Pasteur. Ivanovsky discovered viruses that cause diseases in the plants. And Bijernik coined the term contagium vivum fluidum. That means it's a poisonous fluid. And Stanley was able to crystallize the viruses. Why I gave you this means you have to know these scientists' names are very important. They might ask you in the exam. Now, structure of the virus. So if you look at the structure of the virus, you just see a genetic material. The genetic material can be either DNA or RNA, which can be either single-stranded, double-stranded RNA or DNA. And it is covered by a protein coat. And this is called together, the individual units are called the capsomeres. And the whole protein coat is called as the capsid. So when this capsid is broken down, or if the integrity of this is broken down, the virus can be destroyed. Now, plant diseases, tobacco mosaic virus, cauliflower mosaic virus, human diseases, influenza, herpes, and AIDS. There are many diseases, but from your exam point of view, if you learn this, this is fine. Now, viroids, this were discovered by O.P. Diner. Again, this is an important name. Infectious agents with free RNA of low molecular weight. So, if you look at this, if they are infectious agents with no protein coat, actually, it's not low molecular weight. It has to be with no protein coat. That is why they were named as, though the molecular weight was low, they, since they did not have a protein coat or a capsid, they were called viroids and they cause potato spindle disease. Now, the last is lichens. As I said, fungus can come in association with an algae and this results in a symbiotic relationship known as lichens. It is between an algae. The algal partner is called phycobiont and the fungal partner is called as the mycobiont. So you know algae are photosynthesizing organisms. So algae provides food and fungi provides shelter and absorbs the nutrients for algae. So algae is basically a cook and fungi supplies all the materials. They are good pollution indicators because whenever they disappear, it indicates that it is the area is polluted. So this completes the lesson, biological classification. Now let us look into the tests. Now let us look into test 2, biological classification. Take a test. Since I have already, I hope if you go through it, you will come to know. And since you are also seeing us demonstrating, I am not going to explain all these details. I am straight away going to go to test. So, of the following, which is not a type of bacteria reproduction? So, it is obviously budding, because budding is seen in yeast. Save and next. Regarding chrysophytes, which of the following is not a feature? Photosynthetic. So, it is none of the above, because all these are the features of chrysophytes. Identify the wrongly matched sporozoans, plasmodium, slime molds, saprophytic protists, flagellated protozoans, paramecium, slime molds, plasmodium. It is flagellated protozoan because paramecium is a ciliated protozoan. Save and next. Regarding nutrition in fungi, choose the incorrect one. Can live as symbionts in association with algae as lichens? Yes. Absorb soluble organic matter from dead substrates? Yes. Can live as symbionts in association of the plants, roots of higher plants as a rhizome? Depend on living plants and animals as parasites. So if you look at it, immediately I have seen students saying all are correct, but please look at the word rhizome here. It is not rhizome, it is mycorrhiza. So this is the choice which is incorrect. Choose the odd one out. Now zoospores, oospores, sporangiospores and conidia, it is the oospores. The rest are asexual spores. So remember our BOVA and zoom the computer screen. Now choose the odd one out. Basidiospores, conidia, sporangiospores, zoospores, basidiospores, because the others are asexual spores. Only basidiospore is a sexual spore. Choose the odd one out. Oospores, ascospores, basidiospores, zoospores, zoospores. Now choose the odd one out. Ascospores, sporangiospores, basidiospores, oospores, sporangiospores. Now here, these questions, you need to be very careful because apparently they will all, apparently they will all look alike. But when you really look into them, then you will realize it. You need to look for the details. An eye for detail is very, very important. Now, regarding asexual spores, deuteromycetes generally not found. Asexual spores in deuteromycetes, please understand. Basidiomycetes reproduce only by asexual spores. Now if you look at it, both are incorrect. So the choices both are incorrect. Now viruses contain both of the above, either of the above, DNA or RNA. So it can have either DNA or the RNA as the genetic material. So it is either of the above. Infectious free RNA that causes potato spindle tuber disease was named as viroid. So that is true. It was named so because RNA of the viroid was of low molecular weight. No, as I said, it was called viroid because of its lack of protein coat or the capsid. So if you look at it, what would be the option? A and R. A and R, okay. But R is the not. It was named so because RNA of the viroid was of low molecular coat. Why it was named viroid, it is correct. But RNA of the viroid was of low molecular weight is wrong. So, organisms that are not included in the five kingdom system of classification are lichens, viruses, and viroids. None of the above, all of the above, all of the above. Archaea bacteria differ from other bacteria in having different cell wall structure. True. Methanogens live in marshy areas and halophiles live in hot springs. No. Halophiles live in salty areas. Methanogens are present in the gut of several ruminant animals. True. So it is 1 and 3 are correct, but 2 is incorrect. The sexual cycle involves the following three steps. Fusion of protoplasm between two motile or non-motile gametes called plasmogamy. Fusion of two nuclei called karyogamy. Meiosis and zygote resulting in diploid spores. Now we need to find out. So it is fusion of protoplasm between two motile or non-motile gametes is called plasmogamy, yes. Fusion of two nuclei, karyogamy, is correct. Meiosis and zygote resulting in diploid spores, this is wrong. So 1 and 2 are correct and 3 is incorrect. In phycomycetes, asexual reproduction takes place by zoospores or aplanospores. Here you see they are given non-motile zoospores and motile aplanospores. It is wrong. These spores are exogenously produced in sporangium. They are produced endogenously. That is, they are produced inside the body. A zygospore is formed by the fusion of two gametes, right? If these gametes are similar in morphology, it should be only isogamous, but here oogamy is included. So this is wrong. Or dissimilar anisogamous is correct. See, in our attention, we tend to overlook at these clues here. So that is why you tend to lose marks. And after giving your test, you will realize that you have lost it. So here, all the three are incorrect. Okay, now I'm going to end the test. Okay, so here it shows that the legend says that all the answers are correct, and so I'm getting a full mark. Suppose I have left question number 4, then I will get an unanswered question here. Then suppose I have made a mistake in question number 7, it will be showing as incorrect. Then if I click there, the correct answer will be known. I can make a note of it. So now let me take you back to the home page. So here you are once again, I'm saying. Now you look at all your questions, you have seen how the tests are there. It is helping you to understand NCERT text line by line without your knowledge. Even if you sit to memorize it meticulously, it is not possible unless you are facing such questions that will help you to think and then give you the correct answer. With this, we have come to the end of today's class. Note here, the NEET packages have 38 3 full hour tests with 15 original tests and 20 plus past year papers. So this is very, very important. As I told you that the game changers will be there for you, that has to be new to you. So that which are not being come in any of the entrance exams, which the possibility of which may appear is what you have it in the original test. And by taking up the NEET full test and this package, it will be really helpful for you to thoroughly understand your strengths, analyze your weaknesses, then prepare adequately and see that you complete all the tests so you can buy this test. You can also book the slots for one-to-one teaching with tutors. For any inquiries, mail your query to info@clay6.com.